Well, Miss Jarrett, obviously we want to hear from you a few things, and so with your permission, I'd like to ask you a few questions.
Please.
You have a very, very enthusiastic audience here. These are mostly entrepreneurs from around the world who have committed to women empowerment and great organizations who have supported it. And they obviously are so grateful for you taking time out of your busy schedule and sharing with you a few reflections. First, we would like to know from you really the work of the council in the White House and why this is important and why President Obama thinks that it's important.
Thank you. Well, first of all, it's just a terrific opportunity for me to have a chance to address people from all over the world who care as deeply as we do about the empowerment of women. And 4 years ago this month, almost to the week, President Obama created the White House Council on Women and Girls that I am delighted to chair. And the mission of the council is, simply put, to make sure that every agency, every department, every part of the federal government is doing everything within its power to promote and support women and girls in our policies, in our programs, in the legislation that we present before Congress. And so it can be everything from, for example, tomorrow, President Obama is signing the reauthorization of the Violence Against Women Act. Yes. Hooray. It took far too long to get passed, I might say, but we were determined to strengthen it, not simply just reauthorize it. And so now there are provisions that protect Native American women, there are provisions that protect the LGBT community, and there are provisions that protect immigrants who are not here legally. And those were all important ways of strengthening the act, in addition to resources to help women get the help that they need when they are victims of violence. And so we're so proud for that accomplishment. So that's one accomplishment. And then we're also, for example, encouraging young girls to go into science and technology and engineering and math, and providing them the pathway and the mentorship that they need to go into those fields. And so every agency has accomplishments so far, and we have a robust international agenda going forward. Last year at the UN General Assembly, as a result of a challenge from President Obama, Secretary Clinton and I announced Equal Futures, which is a terrific new program where we're inviting leaders from around the world to engage with us and develop new strategies to enhance women's participation in politics and the economy. And we'll be having a terrific session at the World Bank in April to highlight what we've accomplished so far and to announce new countries that have joined our membership. So the spectrum, the sky is the limit, but I would close by saying that what's so important is that government can only do so much. The long-term success of empowering women really does rest in the private sector. And so this is important that we have partnerships, which is really why I wanted to be here with you all today.
Well, on that notion, I would like to ask you then, here you have committed business leaders who are really struggling to build the business case, and we heard some phenomenal examples this morning already. But what is your view on the business case, not just doing the right thing, but doing the smart thing?
Well, there is a terrific business case to be made. For example, a few years ago, 3 years ago, our Council on Economic Advisors released a report that demonstrates that if you have workplace flexibility, for example, it increases the productivity of the workforce. And it makes sense if people are happier, if they feel as though their employers are sensitive to their obligations and responsibilities outside of the workplace and accommodate them, that it creates an environment where people are more likely to feel loyal and stay, so you don't have the high turnover, and thrive. And so there is a strong business case to be made, we believe, for workplace flexibility. And so I think that as you're thinking about the productivity of the workforce, you should also recognize that women are now graduating from college, for example, at the same rates as men, far different than when I graduated from college just a few years ago. Why is that so funny? They're graduating from graduate school here in the United States at a higher rate than men, yet women still only earn 77 cents on the dollar and less than that for women of color. So we still have a long way to go to try to provide equality in the workplace. And the reason why that's so important, obviously, is it's not just a women's issue anymore. If you look at, in the United States now, two-thirds of all households either have two working parents or women as a sole breadwinner. And so a woman's contribution to the economy of the family is more important now than it was, say, when I was a child. And so recognizing that these are not just women's issues, they're family issues and therefore society issues, I think is a way to get a broader buy-in to what we're trying to accomplish.
Well, this is obviously great for us to hear this, because the women's empowerment principles are preaching that as its basic proposition, value proposition. Then more generally speaking, when you look at the private sector overall, what do you think the private sector could do more, or where would you like to see progress? How do you see the role of the private sector in making real progress on this big issue of women's empowerment?
Well, I'm so glad you asked that question. So I think tone starts at the top, and so I always like to brag about my boss, President Obama. He has made sure that his cabinet and his appointments, whether they're to the judiciary, including his two appointments to the Supreme Court, who are extraordinarily qualified women, to the people in the White House, his deputy chief of staff, his White House counsel, his Secretary of Homeland Security, his Secretary of Health and Human Services. He has made sure that his cabinet really reflects the diversity of our country. He believes we make better decisions, that we will govern better and be more productive, and that he will make better decisions if he is influenced and advised by a wide cross-section of the American people. And we believe that that is the same philosophy that's important, particularly for companies that expect to be global. Mm-hmm. We are in a global marketplace, and therefore you cannot simply have a board that reflects a very small microcosm of society. If you really want to have the best ideas and the best innovation and ingenuity, then surround yourself with diversity. So diversity in the boardroom is important. Boardroom in the C-suite among the senior executives is important. And that will set the tone. And I also think, and you and I discussed this a moment before we come in, you have to have transparency and metrics for success. And I'll tell you a short story. When I was in Chicago, I was a member of an organization called the Women's Network. And what we started to do every year was to publish, just publish, you know, no editorial, just publish the Chicago-based companies and their board representation. And it was just amazing how in one short year, the number of women on the boards increased. And it became, you know, a competition. And people knew this scorecard was going to come out. And so I think sometimes just the transparency is an important factor in success. And so I am a strong believer that the tone does start at the top, and that if the whoever is the leader of the organization, whether it's the private sector or the public sector, if you signal that diversity is important and that women have an important role to play, then it tends to trickle down throughout the organization.
Wonderful. This is also the spirit of the women's empowerment principles. It starts with the leadership commitment, but then it needs to be followed through all internal measures, including disclosure. And we hope the disclosure framework on the women's empowerment principles will enjoy a big, big take up in the years to come. Finally, I'd like to ask you, how then does President Obama work with the private sector on these issues? It's obviously a huge, huge agenda, and where to start and how to start is often quite a choice to be made. Yeah.
Well, a data like today is very important. I think it's so important for us to get, all jokes aside, outside of Washington and talking directly to the grassroots and the people who are out around the world in a position to make a difference. We're always looking for best practices. So for example, we had a forum at the White House on workplace flexibility, and we invited in companies who are on the cutting edge to demonstrate and tell their story firsthand about why it was important to them to do what they did. Another example of initiative that the First Lady is launching is joining forces. It is a way mm-hmm. of getting our military men and women, when they come home, employed. And so many times people come out of the military and they need help transferring their skills to the private sector. And out of this initiative, just this week alone, we met with 40 companies from around the country, all who are actively engaged in new programs for employing our veterans. And so Walmart, for example, made an amazing commitment that they will offer a job to every serviceman and woman who is honorably discharged within a year of their discharge. I mean, that's just amazing. And when they did it, suddenly other companies said, well, you know what, why don't we do the same thing? And so that is just amazing. And when you think about it, in our country, it's terrible to think of how many of our homeless population are women veterans. And so it demonstrates to us, and the president is absolutely committed to making sure that we eradicate homelessness among our men and women who made this enormous sacrifice for our country. And so there are many, many different ways where there are opportunities for private-public partnership, because we recognize that the economic engine really rests with the private sector. And so we need to make sure that we are leveraging opportunities and sharing best practices and providing a forum for collaboration.
Wonderful, Ms. Jarrett. I know time is very much on the run, especially on
your
side.
Are we done?
Maybe you want to share just the last piece of wisdom, some encouragement. For example, one of our big challenges here is to become a critical mass, which we are not yet, despite the quite impressive growth of the women's empowerment principles and now being taken up in so many countries, it's still a minority movement. We are still all aware that the forces of resistance are quite significant, and we still have a long way to go. So any guidance or last words you could give us on that journey?
Absolutely. First of all, change begins with one person. And so the fact that you've already grown, you're mushroomed in such a short period of time of companies that are participating, I think is important. And I always like to tell the story of Lilly Ledbetter. The president's first bill that he signed when he took office was the Lilly Ledbetter Fair Pay Act. And for those of you who don't know the story of Lilly, she worked for a company and worked hard for decades and had no idea that she wasn't being paid equal to men. And when she finally found out, one of her colleagues told her, you know, I make this, and she realized, oh my gosh, we're doing the same job, and there is no equal pay here. And so she brought a lawsuit against her company. But because the statute of limitations had lapsed all the way up to the Supreme Court, her case was thrown out. And so we realized we needed legislation that would say that the statute shouldn't toll until after you've been on notice of discrimination, because how are you going to possibly bring a lawsuit if you don't even know you're being discriminated against? And so we passed the Lilly Ledbetter Fair Pay Act. Now, Lilly, the reason why I tell her story to you is that because her case went to the Supreme Court, she never was able to get any redress. But she continued to fight on behalf of all similarly situated women. And so to this day, she comes to the White House all the time, and she's so proud that the statute bears her name because it's benefiting so many other women in the workplace, even though she didn't benefit. And so I think the fact that you are all here today, you are the best people to go out and talk about how we can really empower women, because you are so respected by your colleagues and you have the ability to influence people. And the fact that this organization has mushroomed in such a short period of time, my last word would be to you, think big. And yes, change is hard, and goodness knows the Obama administration, we believe in hope and change, and we have discovered in our first 4 years how hard that might be, but you've got to be resilient, and you have to be tenacious, and you have to not give up. So I'm just so proud of each and every one of you who's here today, and I'm just thrilled that I had a chance to stop by and chat a little bit with you. Look forward to working with you in the future.
Ms. Jarrett, thank you so much. Thank you so much.